Okay, so we're going today to talk about determinants. At least some of you, at least some students in this class have seemingly seen this material before, like I saw it in some of the tests when I'd asked if a matrix was invertible or not, but so determinants and hold on a second. I was right to be skeptical. Let's not start the class by calling it the wrong thing. So a determinant is a number associated with a square matrix. And determinants used to be kind of front and center in linear algebra. Like if you go back and read textbooks that were written a few decades ago, they'll really sort of hammer this idea home. They've definitely sort of suffered a fall from grace since then. They're very complicated to define. They're not easy to work with. They don't really provide a lot of intuitive understanding. So I think the most common practice now is to just teach the material that you're going to need later in the class, and otherwise leave determinants alone. And that's the process that I am going to follow. So they're associated with square matrices, and they're defined inductively. And that inductive definition is kind of the curse of the determinant. It's what makes it so hard to work with. So let's start by looking at the easy case, or if not easy, at least quick. You've got a 2x2 matrix A. You want to find its determinant. That's written as det A. And you take this 2x2 matrix and you're going to multiply the diagonal and the anti-diagonal elements, and you're going to subtract them. So the determinant in this particular case is 7 - 8, or -1. Another way to denote determinants is to write them as a matrix, but to use simply vertical lines instead of the brackets that you see on matrices. So if we want to talk about the determinant of 2, 8, 6, 4, if we want to talk about the determinant of the 2x2 matrix that has those values as its entries, we could write it like that. And Again, just multiply the diagonal elements, multiply the anti-diagonal elements, and subtract them. If that were all there was to determinants, I wouldn't have started this lecture by saying they were hard to work with. Things get quickly worse if you look at a 3 by 3 matrix, just pulling an example out of the air. To find the determinant of a 3 by 3 matrix, you're going to select a row or you're going to select a column. And some rows or some columns might be easier to work with than others. That will be clear once we've seen this process through. But it doesn't fundamentally matter which row or column you select. Let's select the third entry. Now, you're going to do some addition and you're going to do some subtraction. And the addition and the subtraction that you do is going to be based on a sign chart. We don't need the whole thing. A 3 by 3 matrix corresponds to a 3 by 3 sign chart. That is, we're going to put positive and negative signs in an array. And we're only interested in the row or the column that we selected. So we start in the upper left with a positive sign, and then we alternate. Positive, negative, positive, negative, positive. So we're going to have -4, and then we're going to have +0, as it were. And we're going to take that 2, and we're going to take that -4, and we're going to take that 0, and we're going to multiply them all by something. So it's going to be 2 times something minus 4 times something plus 0 times something. And what is the something? Well, let's start with this 2. I did not mean to erase it. Let's start with that 2. We can look at the column that 2 is in, and we can look at the row that 2 is in. And if we scribble out the row, and we scribble out the column, what's left is a 2 by 2 matrix. And what we're multiplying 2 by is the determinant of the matrix that remains. When we scribble out that row and we scribble out that column. I did not think this through. I was like, oh, I'll just scribble it out and then I'll undo. There we go. That's what I wanted to do. And now, what about this 4? Well, exactly the same idea. We are now looking at this 4, we scribble out the row it's in, we scribble out the column it's in, and what remains are 4 numbers in a 2x2 grid. In other words, what remains is a matrix, and we take the determinant of that matrix. Now 0, and of course it's kind of academic because 0 times anything is 0, so it hardly matters what you write here, but it's the same idea. You scribble out the row, you scribble out the column, what remains is a 2x2 matrix, and you take its determinant. Of course, I can talk about scribbling out very lively because I know I can just erase the scribble. Or if you're sort of working pen and paper, you would just cover the column and the row up. And then each of these determinants we can find using the technique of the previous frame. We've defined the determinant of a 2x2 matrix. So 2 minus 3, 1 minus 0, 1 minus 0 again, and we get what? Negative 2 minus 4, or negative 6. Let's see. Any notes? Don't get confused by the sign chart. The sign chart is telling us whether or not to flip. Let me just sort of ask what would happen if we had a negative 2 there. Well, the sign chart says positive, negative, positive. Well, thus a negative 2 is a negative 2. So if we have negative signs, be a little careful with that sign chart. Theoretically, this inductive process just generalizes. You can have a 4x4 matrix. And you can ask for its determinant. And you just in big old quotation marks here, select a row or a column, you create the part of the sine chart that you need, which is the row or the column that you've selected, and then you go from there. But of course, you can see in practice, well, now when we start with 7 or -7, thanks to this sine chart, we scribble out the column, we scribble out the row, we get the determinant of a 3x3 matrix. And then to find this determinant, we have to go back here and do all this work. Then you get plus 2, another 3x3 determinant, minus 1, another 3x3 determinant, plus 2, another 3x3 determinant. All of those 3x3 determinants are a pain, and you've got 4 of them. And then if you went up to 5x5, you would be doing all the work on this frame 5 times, and so on. So in practice, I would never compute by hand a determinant of a matrix bigger than 3x3. And really, in practice, I'd avoid computing determinants if at all possible. I mean, if you have a computer do this, I mean, even a computer would be chugging and taking days at a time. If you have like a 50x50 matrix and you're trying to use this method of finding the determinant, computers can approximate determinants using better algorithms. But obviously doing this by hand, not really feasible when the matrices get big. The exception to that would be if we have what we call a sparse matrix. And sparse is kind of a weird, sparse with an S, with a C. That's something I should probably know, but I don't. Yep, the S is right. I thought it looked weird, but sparse is kind of an oddity in mathematics, in that you talk about sparse matrices all the time, but there's no formal definition for what a sparse matrix is. I mean, a sparse matrix is a matrix where almost all of the entries are 0. Everyone agrees with that. It's just that almost all is not a formal mathematical definition. And as far as I know, nobody's ever tried to formalize sparse beyond that rather vague statement. The reason that taking determinants of sparse matrices, even quite large sparse matrices can be done quickly, will sort of show itself if we select a row or a column that is almost all zeros. Because you see what this row gives us, it's zero times a determinant plus, minus, plus, minus, plus. It's zero times a determinant minus zero times a determinant plus zero times a determinant minus zero times a determinant plus one times a determinant. And calculating, wait, did I positive, negative, positive, negative, positive. Yep, that's right. And calculating almost all of those determinants would be completely pointless because zero times anything is zero. So it doesn't matter what this determinant is. It goes away when you multiply it by zero. Similarly, everything except this last entry. The only determinant we get from the first row is we now need the determinant of this. Well, once again, if we can find a row or a column that just has a few zeros in it, we're in a very good situation. And we can do that for a second time. The first column of this matrix is almost all zero. So when you find the determinant, again, you get zero times something that doesn't matter, minus zero times something that doesn't matter, plus zero times something that doesn't matter, minus one times something that does matter. So using that first column, we get negative one, negative from the sign chart, times the determinant of this. And now we can select that second column and just finish out the problem early. Zero times something, minus zero times something, plus zero times something. That second column gives us zero. And the determinant is one times negative one times zero equals zero. So finding determinants can be okay, assuming that the matrix is sparse. And there are a lot of sparse matrices in very important applications. So this is kind of a detour, but the Google matrix. Google's search algorithm is based around linear algebra. It's a billions by field in size matrix, where every row of the matrix represents a web page, and every column of the matrix represents a web page, and all of the entries are zero unless there's a hyperlink from the web page in the row, the column, to the web page in the row. Since most web pages do not have hyperlinks between them, the Google matrix is incredibly sparse. Almost all of its billions and billions of entries are zero. So that does happen in real world situations. Even so, the determinant is usually avoided for reasons that I'll get to by the end of this lecture. Let's state a few properties of the determinant. One property that the determinant has, which is not at all obvious, is that the determinant is well-defined. If I went back here, let me see. When I found the determinant in this example, I used the third row and I got -6. If instead of using the third row, I had used the second column, I would also have gotten -6. That's not at all obvious from the definition of the determinant, but it is true. So we can talk about the determinant of a matrix. This next property, it's going to seem kind of specialized, but it does show up in some good applications. A matrix is called upper or lower triangular if all the entries below respectively above the main diagonal are zero. So this is a definition, not a property. We'll get to the property in a moment, but say this matrix is upper triangular. Here is the main diagonal. All of the entries below the main diagonal are zero. This matrix is lower triangular. Here is the main diagonal. All of the entries above the main diagonal are zero. And finding the determinant of a matrix is usually hard, but finding the determinant of a triangular matrix is easy. The determinant of a triangular matrix is the product of the diagonal entries. So the determinant of this matrix is 6. 1 times 1 times 1. The determinant of this matrix is 12. 1 times 2 times 6. In particular, and this is really the main application of this theorem, we might get a chance to talk about this more later in the course. But if a matrix is both upper and lower triangular, that means it just has entries on its diagonal, and this theorem still holds. So the determinant of such a matrix is just a product, the product of the diagonal elements. Now, here's where determinants kind of find their use. Let's state the following theorem. You don't have to commit this theorem to memory, though. It's just, we're only going to use it one place in the course, and it's going to be like 5 minutes from now. This theorem asks the question, how do elementary row operations change the determinant? Of a matrix. If you take a matrix and perform Gauss-Jordan elimination on it, what happens to the determinant? And the answer is that of the three elementary row operations, row swaps change the sign of the determinant. So if the determinant was positive 2 and you swap the first and the second row, now the determinant is negative 2. Multiplying a row by a constant multiplies the determinant by that same constant. And I mean, this is true even if the constant is zero. But if it's the constant is zero, that's not an elementary row operation. So let me make that explicit that we're talking about multiplying by non-zero constants. And it's kind of unintuitive, but the most complicated row operation, which is to multiply a row by a constant and then add it to another row, results in no change at all to the determinant. And the actual part of this theorem that we care about is the following corollary. Gauss, Jordan, elimination. Cannot turn a matrix with a determinant of zero to a matrix with a non-zero determinant. Going back to this theorem, if the determinant is zero and you perform a row operation, well, negative zero is still zero. Zero times any constant is still zero. And of course, if you don't change the determinant, it remains zero. So none of the things that happen during Gauss-Jordan elimination can make a determinant of zero into something else. And this is also true that Gauss-Jordan elimination cannot turn a matrix with a non-zero determinant into a matrix whose determinant is zero. If the determinant is non-zero and you change its sign, still not zero. If it's non-zero and you multiply it by a non-zero constant, still not zero. If it's non-zero and you don't change it, well, of course, still not zero. So Gauss-Jordan elimination sends matrices whose determinants are zero to other matrices whose determinant is zero. And it takes matrices with non-zero determinants and sends them to other matrices with non-zero determinants. What's the significance of this? Well, let's remind ourselves. A matrix is invertible if and only if Gauss-Jordan elimination turns that matrix to I. And the determinant of I equals 1. The determinant of I equals 1 because of this. Remember that I is the matrix that has ones down the diagonal and is a zero everywhere else. If you multiply one by itself a bunch of times, the result is 1. So the determinant is related to the question of whether or not the matrix has an inverse. Because if a matrix has a determinant of 0, then Gauss-Jordan elimination cannot send it to the identity matrix I. It cannot turn that 0 determinant into 1. And in fact, we can state the following stronger theorem. A matrix is invertible say a matrix A is invertible if and only if the determinant of that matrix is non-zero. Which is equivalent to saying that a matrix is not invertible if and only if the determinant is 0. So this is a characterization of invertibility that does not involve finding the inverse. And, that initially sounds like a much bigger deal, unfortunately, than it actually is. What I've said in the past is that we don't really care what a matrix's inverse is, we just care whether it has a matrix. I've also said that for numerical stability issues, reasons, we do not want to find inverses. This seems like it should be a solution to that, except that finding determinants is even worse than finding inverses. So you don't want to find determinants either. And let me make a kind of judgment statement, I guess. Determinants are bad. If you're doing something and you decide that the best way to do it is to find the determinant, then in particular, you're probably doing something wrong. You should step back and reassess. And I mean, maybe I should soften this a little. I mean, people do very interesting research with determinants. There are some very interesting kind of applications of determinants, but those research and those applications are always done on like a graduate level. As far as sort of our purposes in an undergraduate linear algebra class, there are a very limited set of circumstances where we'd want to find a determinant. And I especially want to relate this statement to this theorem. And I want to make a statement that if the determinant of A is close to zero, it's very hard to get use full info. Say that we have a large matrix, even a relatively large matrix. I mean, 100 by 100 seems large for us, but I've just said that Google matrix has billions of rows and billions of columns. But you take a reasonably large matrix so that it's not possible even for a computer to calculate the determinant using that algorithm we gave earlier in the class. The computer can only run some kind of numerical approximation algorithm. And the computer tells you that the determinant of A is 2.7 times 10 to the negative 34th. So in our calculator, this would be 2.7e negative 34. What does this tell you? Well, if the determinant really were 2.7 times 10 to the negative 34th, it would tell you that this matrix has an inverse. The determinant is non-zero, therefore an inverse exists. This looks like rounding error. It looks like maybe the determinant is actually zero. If the determinant is actually zero, that tells you that an inverse does not exist. So is this rounding error or is this the real answer? There's no way to know, really. And there's therefore no way to tell whether the determinant, whether A is invertible or not. And kind of the natural reply to that is, okay, but this has to tell us something, right? I mean, if the determinant being zero tells you something, then sort of by continuity, the determinant being this close to zero, should also be telling us something. Like maybe it's telling us that the inverse exists, but it's really time consuming to find. Or the inverse exists, but there will be really bad rounding error if we find it. And that intuition is completely wrong. The determinant being this close to zero tells us literally nothing. It's an all or nothing proposition. If the determinant is zero, that tells us one thing. If the determinant is not zero, that tells us a different thing. And it's that all or nothing nature of the determinant that causes people to be so down on it. People want to get sort of more powerful information than the determinant can provide, and people want to get that information without running these extremely slow numerical algorithms. So like, this comes up a lot in programming, where a program wants to take the inverse of a matrix. The programmer knows that not every matrix is invertible. So the programmer thinks, okay, I'll put an if statement somewhere in the program. If the determinant equals zero, give an error message. And that type of thing really doesn't work. It has to be handled in other ways. For our purposes, we're in this class, we're going to use the determinant as a tool to find other quantities called eigenvalues. Might be familiar to some of you. That is a very classroom exercise, a very classroom application. In the real world, you would not use determinants to do that. You'd use other algorithms. But because in the classroom, we're just working with 2x2 matrices and 3x3 matrices, and the determinants aren't so bad, we can get away with it. And short of letting all students use a computer with sort of numerical software on it, we kind of have to do it that way if we want to work with eigenvalues, which we definitely do. So, in spite of this lecture being kind of negative, we do need to be able to find determinants because we're going to use it as a tool to do more interesting things later in the course.